Awesome. Not as awesome as tomorrow, but still awesome. We are finally going to start talking about APIs. Oh, man, APIs, what's it all about? Can anybody tell me what API is an acronym for? Okay. I don't know, let's give her a chance. Oh, perfect, right? API stands for Application Programming Interface, or Program Interface, right? So what does this mean? Like, this is the way we can use something. Okay, so we've explored the DOM API a little bit. That was document, that query selector, that add event listener, right? These are all things that we have available to us on the DOM, the document object model, right? That's kind of the DOM API. And there's other APIs, too, that you could think of, like maybe our game, one of our games, like our Russian roulette, had some, like, API calls, and, like, that's why we were able to use a lot of the same code, whether it was from the terminal or whether it was from the browser. All we had to do was get this game instance, and we had to play it a little differently for the visual aspect. But besides that, we were still making the same calls into our game instance, right? So the most common one that we're going to be using all the time is going and getting and interacting with data. Okay, so this is really, this is exciting. Yeah, there's not too much like visual stuff for me to actually show you. So data, let's talk a little bit about just how, like, what's going on with the internet and all that first, right? So if I were to draw it out, we have our client. This is, like, your computer. And it goes, and it makes requests. Requests to a server. So this is kind of someone else's computer. Okay? And then the server's gonna go do something, and it's gonna come back and give a response. Okay, so there's kind of this rotating path that keeps occurring. This happens for everything. So, like, when you go to like facebook.com, that's a domain name, that's Facebook's domain name. They also have an IP address. Every computer has an IP address. That's just like, I think it's four numbers separated by periods. I forget the ranges. I think it's 0 to 99 or something around there. And you can actually type directly into Google, like, an IP address, and it will take you there. But it's really hard for us to remember, like, oh, I'm going to 117.32.6. So we just say, like, oh, Google.com, right? So this is like part of how the internet's kind of structured up. And so when we do that, the client is making this request, and it's saying, like, oh, I want to be taken to this page. I want to see what happens. And so it goes over and it hits a server. The server then takes this request, grabs the information that we need, and then goes ahead and gives it back, and then the computer displays it. Okay, so that's kind of this constant process. So, attached to the server, there's also usually, like, we can say, oh, this marker is kind of rubbish. Where's that double-sided marker? It walked off. This is kind of like, we'll call this a database. Databases, we don't really learn much about them until next unit, but for all intents and purposes, you can think of it as like it stores data. So maybe there's like a series of users on Facebook. It could be your friends, right? And they all have, there's like an ID column, and then there's like a name column, and maybe there's their age, and some other information about them. And this is all stored as a database. It's a little bit like we can't like visually see it. It's all being stored. You can kind of think of it as like a big Excel spreadsheet, right? And so if we were like, okay, let me go get all my friends. When you click on Facebook and you click on your friends list, right? That goes, it hits what's like a route to the back end, which is a request saying like, hey, get all of this person's friends. Hits the server. The server goes, okay. It communicates with this database. It's going to grab all of your friends as like a big chunk of data, probably like an array of objects. And then it's going to come be a response. It's going to come as a response, and then it's going to paint the friends for you on the screen so that you can scroll through. Okay, so that's what's happening here. Okay, so this is like interacting. So there's routes. These requests we can think of as kind of like a route to hit. So like when we request something from a domain name, right, like Facebook.com, we're like making a request. But we can also make requests for data. Okay? And so these are generally what we think of when we're like, and what we talk a lot about when we talk about APIs is this data. For example, let's go, and you'll see APIs are all over the place. If you haven't already, you should get like the JSON View Chrome extension. I think it was in our local environment setup. But if you don't already have it, it will probably be helpful for you to click it and to access it. It looks like this. And it makes things a bit more readable. So anyway, there's lots of APIs out there that are available. Some you have to pay for, and especially if you're like using a lot of data from it a lot, like if you're making thousands of calls or something. Some you need to have certain authentication where you have to be like a valid, like you have to, they have to give you permission to go ahead and grab this information, right? Because things have to be secure. You know, I probably, if I could go to Facebook and grab all of Danny's messages, that wouldn't be okay, right? Like, people would be very upset. So because of that, like, I'd have to have the correct permissions. But then some are completely free and open, and we can use them. So, for example, there's a really cool Rick and Morty API you can look into. And so the very first thing you do when you're trying to learn a new API is what? What do we think it might be? Do what? It's already made. See what it's about? Okay, yeah, in other words, read the documentation, right? The documentation tells you how to use an API, the specific API. So it's really important to always read the documentation. If you don't know how to make a specific request and you haven't looked up the documentation yet and you say, hey, Corey, how do I get this? It's not working. And I go, have you read the documentation? And you say, no. I'll go, okay. Well, go do that and then let me know when you've done that. So, okay. We're going to look more at like REST APIs today. Don't worry too much about what that means. And so this one says, like, okay, the base URL contains information about all available APIs, resources. All requests are GET requests. We're going to learn more about that later. There's a few different types. This is part of something called a RESTful API, because sometimes you might have noticed that we get information, which is what we'll be doing today, is getting information. Sometimes, you know, when you're creating, like, a new message to send to somebody else, that's you creating something, right? But that information still needs to be stored in a database. So that's you creating a message. So that's actually called a post. That sometimes you might want to edit something you've already written, like on Slack, right? That's a patch request. So there's all these different, sometimes you delete something, that's a delete request. So there's all these different types of requests, but today we're going to focus just on GET. Okay? And so we can kind of read some stuff and let's just see, like, okay, so this is how we could grab a character. So let's go ahead and copy this. Oops. And if you go into your, create a new tab in your browser and plug it in, this automatically makes a GET request for you. It has no other option. And it gives me back this. So this is the response. The request was when I typed that in and hit enter. So it went to some server somewhere. It had access to the characters out of its database. And then it gave it back this response. The response that we're currently seeing is called JSON. That's like a, what's the actual acronym? I think that's JavaScript Object Notation. Okay, and essentially it's just, it's a bunch of, it's an object. It's an object within an object. Here, like let me copy all of this. Right, we've seen some labs where we already had a bunch of data, right? This is a lot of data. So I can copy this. And let's play with it a little bit. I'm going to go into VS Code just so we can take a more in-depth look at the data. Okay, let's go ahead and make a file. Just going to call this index.js, and I'll say let data, and I'm just going to paste this whole object here. Object says info, right? Keep in mind, different APIs will give back different JSON, all right? So you have to play and look at the data that's coming back to see exactly how we can access the information. So like, okay, so for this one, I say, okay, I have info, and this says that I have 493 characters. All right. I have 25 pages. So sometimes when there's such large amounts of data, they don't give you the whole database call at once, right? Because if we tried to, like, ping the Simpsons, right, we wouldn't want, like, thousands of characters. We would want maybe 100 characters at a time. Otherwise, it might take a long time to go and retrieve all of that, and that's a big, huge amount to play with. I'm sure when you've gone to websites before and it's had a list of things, and then sometimes it says, like, click the next one, and you'll see the next set of things, right? This term is technically called pagination, and it's when the data is split up into multiple pages for you to access. It says if we wanted page 2, this is the API that I'd have to hit. I'd have to say rickandmortyapi.com/api/character/?page=2. That's like its direction. And there is no previously because this is the first page. So that's like the info section of this piece of data. We can look, and then we also have this results key. And the results key points to what? An object, an array, and that array is filled with what? Objects, right? So we see that this has an ID of 1. This object is massive. It's got an ID of 1, the name is Rick Sanchez, the status is alive, species, human, empty type, gender, male, origin, it talks about where they're from. That's pointing to an object, it has a location, that's an object. It talks about the episodes that Rick's been in. This is an array of different episodes. Has the URL, and then we end our first object in that array, right? And so then the next one is an object with the ID of 2. IDs are unique, right? Just like when we had this in regular CSS. Name, Morty Smith, status alive. Right, so we're getting all of this data. All right, so let's pretend I wanted to get just have an array of just all the names of the characters. Right, I don't want all of this information. How might I do it on a high level approach? Key into. Okay, yeah, so what's the first thing I'd have to key into?
Results,
yeah. And then what? Yeah, and then I'd have to iterate through it and get all the names, right? Let's just quickly prove that something like that would work. It was result or results? Do we remember?
Results.
Plural? Okay. So I call the data, so I'm going to say let res equal an empty array. And then I'm going to say data dot results dot for each, right? And for each, then I have for each character. And I'm just gonna push inside of my res. I'm gonna push the character.name. And then at the very end, I will console log my res array. Let's see if this works. Let's open up Node. Let me make that bigger. It's probably not big enough. Okay, and then let's and then let's go ahead and run this. So we'll say node at index.js. Didn't like it, freaked out. Said console is not a function. Well, that's totally true. Console.log. Still messing up on console.logs. And we have this array from Rick Sanchez. It looks like it starts with the most main characters of the show, and then it moves into alphabetical order. Questions on that? Right, so this is maybe something we'd want to do. It might, now, hopefully it's not too far of a stretch of the imagination to think like, okay, but maybe I'll take this list, and instead of just making an array, I'm actually adding option tags inside of a select onto a DOM, so that now I have a select bar of all of the characters' names, right? Using the DOM API. Interesting. Okay, so that's that. Let's also talk a little bit about Postman. So at the beginning of the year, in the local environment setup, we had you install Postman. If you have not installed Postman yet, now is probably a good time to start. Although when we're doing GET requests, we really only need the browser, it wouldn't be a bad idea to start familiarizing yourself with Postman. Postman's super cool because of this. As mentioned, you remember I mentioned earlier about like post and put and delete and patch and all that. Didn't go into them, but I mentioned them. Postman allows us to test different types of requests. So, well, the top five are like the main ones. And then you enter the URL here. You're able to, some types of requests need information to be passed with them. So you could pass that in here into your params or your body, depending on what exactly you're passing. You don't really have to worry about that yet. It's just showing so you're familiar with the tool. So for now, you just want to stay where it says that your request is GET, and we have a send. So, okay. In the lesson on GitHub, there's, or I'll post it on Slack, there's a link. There, I'll post. I'm having a hard time posting. Catching it. Okay. Web. Okay, so go check out the dog at CEO/API. Specifically, I want you to use the entirety of this API endpoint, this for a random image, but go ahead and read the documentation first in here. If we go just to get rid of this stuff. I think that's what we need. Yeah, so you'll go to the dog API and see if you can get a random image and go ahead and do it using Postman. Your response should look something like this. Okay? So, how could you look for it? Oh, command spacebar, and then type in Postman. Okay.
Looks like a lady with a jetpack.
I want you to use Postman to get a random image of a dog. Once you can hear my voice, clap your hands twice if you can hear my voice. Okay, how'd we do? Yes, no, maybe so. Why not? Okay. All right, let's do one more minute. All right, let's do it again. Clap your hands once if you can hear my voice. Clap your hands twice if you can hear my voice. All right, if you didn't get there, I'm sure you have plenty of time today to get there. Okay, so what's the first thing that you hopefully did when you went to this? Documentation? Let's be honest, how many of us read the documentation? Yeah. Oh, man, brutal. You read it? Good for you. Right? The first thing we should always do is read the documentation.
Of course.
Yep.
When I clicked on the link you sent, it just gave me a
message. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Then I removed the rest so that it was the same as up here. Sorry, here. I can resend the link. I can send it the more appropriate link. There you go. Okay. Up there now. So this is the different endpoints. So we can use those endpoints for different GET requests to get different things, right? It's gonna say, all right, we're gonna go to this thing, go get the information from the database and give us a different response. So if we wanted to list all the dog breeds, we could copy this. We could go and do our GET request here, paste this in, hit send, and so, it's weird. There we go. Right? This is my response. I'm getting all these types of dogs. So, okay. Different types of bulldogs, different types of bull terriers. No types of cairn, whatever that is. Although we said we were going to look for a random image of a dog. So, okay, I'm going to click for this endpoint. And it says I need to use this API. So I'm going to copy that. Oh, yeah. Okay, thank you. Right, I highlighted too much. This is awkward highlight. Oh, brilliant. Okay, perfect. Gonna copy that. Let's go find ourselves Celine's next pet. And we'll send it. It's a cat, I know. And we see, hey, we got this specific image of a terrier, Silky, right? Some of us probably saw the picture. Maybe that's different here. Mine's set for JSON. Maybe yours is set for HTML or auto. I don't know what yours is set for. Oh, yours is set for day, and it still gave you a picture? Maybe you might have a newer version than I do or something. The real response you actually get back is this. Or you don't actually get a picture. If it's giving you a picture, it's just interpreting that for you already. Instead, it gives you back a message, which has a link to a picture. Right? I could copy this. And I could put that in an image tag in my HTML, or I can even just put it, make a second GET request for, I think I threw in an extra V, and that should give me an image, right? This little, there, it looks a lot like my parents' dog. Hideous. And it also gives us a status, of success, because this was a success. What if I would have misspelled random and done R-N-D-O-M? I also want you to look here. It's a status 200 okay. Okay, so if I go ahead and look at Rindam, I get a 404 not found and this message. Hey, no route for this git. There's this error status and a code 404, which means 404 not found. So every response that you get back comes with a status. If everything is hunky-dory and perfect, it comes back as status 200 okay, is the term. It says everything is, if it's 200 okay, everything's groovy. 300 is something else. I don't really remember. There's a bunch of different statuses, and I think part of the assignment today is you familiarize yourself with some of them. Honestly, the ones you really need to know are like 200, 404, 422, 500. 500 is internal server error, so that means something on the server side screwed up. So when you're creating your own server later on with your own database, if you get back a server side 500, like you haven't set up your database correctly. 404 means like they didn't find this route. 422 I think is unauthorized user. So it's saying like, hey, you don't have permission to see this. And then the status 200 okay. There's some other weird ones out there. I think Selena and I were looking at one the other day. It was like a 418, which means like I'm a teapot. Like, no, that's not something you see, right? You see stat, you say 200 okay, 404, 422, 500. Those are the ones you really need to know, okay? No one's ever going to ask you what a 418 is. If they do, like, be like, yeah, okay, I actually know that one. Somebody said 420 status. Brilliant. Brilliant joke. Anonymous. Okay. I can pay. Okay. So this is like this is the main idea of an API. If we're still having trouble grasping an API, let's try to think of a couple real life examples. One classic example is an ATM machine. So remember, you're not the API. The user's not the API. It's the actual machine itself. So if we were at an ATM, we're able to deposit money, right? We're able to withdraw money, but it's not a bank either, right? But it's communicating to the bank. The bank is like, you know, it goes up and you go like, okay, I want $50 out of you. And then it goes, and you've given it some authentication as well, right? And then it goes and it's going to check how much money you have in your bank. And if you have $50, it's going to give you back $50. If not, it's going to be like, hey, like insubstantial funds or something, right? So that's kind of like a real-life API. It's this idea of communicating, and this ATM is kind of this middleman running back and forth, right? The relationship, again, is often called clients to server, right? This is like also like kind of like being a waiter or waitress, in a sense. Like, literally, they're called servers, right? And you're the client, but and that it's like kind of a stretch. Because really the server, in that sense, is more of the client, as in they are the one with the API, where you would tell them, like, hey, I want such and such, like a hamburger with no cheese. And then they would go, oh, okay. I know, that's if you're already eating meat, you should be eating the cheese. And then they go and they communicate to the kitchen staff, which is like the database, right? And then the kitchen staff makes the hamburger and no cheese, and then the server brings it back to the client, right? That's like the response. Okay, so that's like a real life. Can anyone else think of a different like real life thing? Yeah, Farah.
About that, I was trying to help with some of the website. Like one of the template websites that you make an account, and like we were trying to get some way to like have a map that the person could put their address in. So then blah 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 research, and it was like Google API. So I was like, oh, but I didn't understand it, so like I even got a code from Google, and then I just kind of like hit a wall because I wasn't like able to get through it. So I think it was gonna give me info to like install it on the website, maybe.
Probably. Yeah. Did you read the documentation? I don't know. Jay.
For the weather, so I use Dark Sky API.
Dark Sky API.
For a lot of things, so like widgets on my computer.
Most of you probably remember Claudia at this point, it's 2019. Coding you to set your own API.
Oh, cool.
Like 10,000 calls a day for free. Go over and get
back. Cool.
The jailbreak of fires. Let me use the untechnical term.
Oh.
But that's not at all what it is. Kodi is a server that you run.
Oh, interesting. I thought you had mispronounced my name.
If you Google it, it is not a user-friendly thing, so you can look it up if you want. But
all right.
Explain it in the loosest of terms.
Very cool.
Kodi is merely a server on its own. You add things to it that allow you to stream. It's not streaming natively. It's merely a server. It's a fancy.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. No, actually. Yeah. Deja?
Oh, just, I guess, any streaming device,
that's
what I was going to say, pretty much.
Yeah, you're accessing. Yeah, so these are all real tech APIs, right? Yeah, Will?
Yeah, like, for example, the TSA machines at the airport.
Yeah, for sure, right?
They have a database of all our information and the golden spy house, and, you
know. They're checking in. That's okay, don't worry. Oh, retail, yeah. Doug?
Well, like retail too, if you have any Foursquare and Stripe and PayPal.
Okay.
You'll have like APIs.
Yeah, right. There's everything essentially on the web has some type of API. Not all are public and accessible, but there's quite a few, and part of your assignment today is to find a bunch of different types of APIs. And use Postman to do that. So you get a little bit more familiar with Postman, you get more familiar with APIs, and I think that pretty much covers everything that I wanted to talk about today. Any final questions on this? Okay, rock and roll. So can you, one of somebody in the back post pairs, and then that's what we'll...